Welcome to the monthly podcast presented by JAMA Health Forum. I'm Dr. John Iannian, the director of the Institute for Healthcare Policy and Innovation at the University of Michigan and the editor of JAMA Health Forum. JAMA Health Forum is a peer-reviewed, open-access, online journal focused on health policy, healthcare systems, and population health, and one of 12 specialty journals in the JAMA network. Our podcast each month presents highlights of new content from the journal, including timely interviews with authors of research studies and commentaries. Follow us on jamahealthforum.com, on Apple Podcasts, or wherever you get your multimedia, and on jamanetworkaudio.com. I'm pleased to welcome two guest authors joining this podcast. The first is Dr. Kelsey Owsley. Dr. Owsley is Assistant Professor of Health Policy and Management at the University of Arkansas for Medical Sciences. Her research focuses on access to care, hospital behavior, and public health services. She's the lead author of a new study in JAMA Health Forum titled Association Between U.S. Hospital Service Availability and New 340B Program Participation, written with co-authors from the University of Arkansas and the University of Colorado. Welcome, Kelsey.
Hi, thank you so much for having me.
And we're also joined by Dr. Saye Nikpay. Dr. Nikpay is Associate Professor of Health Policy and Management at the University of Minnesota School of Public Health. Her research focuses on policies to support healthcare safety net providers serving low-income populations. She's the corresponding author of an invited commentary in JAMA Health Forum about the study by Dr. Owsley and colleagues titled Public Hospitals May Use the 340B Program Differently Than Nonprofit Hospitals, written with lead author Claire McGlave at the University of Minnesota. Welcome, Saye.
It's wonderful to be here with you, John, talking about this really important topic.
Thank you. Kelsey, for our listeners who may not be familiar with the 340B discount program, can you briefly describe the program's history and the policy goal it's designed to achieve?
Sure. So the 340B program was created in 1992 in response to rising drug costs, and it allows eligible providers to receive pretty significant discounts on approved outpatient drugs. And the discounts that providers receive is not publicly available, but it is estimated to be anywhere from 20 to 50% off of the list price of the drug. So it is a pretty lucrative program for providers. And the program was initially designed to allow providers to stretch their resources and continue to provide comprehensive patient services. And importantly, it was initially intended to serve providers that disproportionately care for underserved populations, like federally qualified health centers, HIV Ryan White clinics, and really a small number of safety net hospitals. But in 2010, the federal government actually expanded hospital eligibility for the program. And since then, we have really seen tremendous growth in hospital participation in 340B, where now it's estimated that almost half of all U.S. hospitals actually participate in the program.
Thanks. And Saye, would you add any additional insights about the 340B program to the perspective that Kelsey shared?
Yeah, Dr. Owsley is totally right. It was this program that was created several decades ago and originally intended to be quite small. But over the years, due to lack of clarity around the rules and Congress's original intent, this program has grown to encompass, like she said, 50%, nearly half of all hospitals in the U.S. And furthermore, it's 16% of prescription drug spend in the United States. We think about it as a drug discount program, so it's lowering the cost of drugs. But over the years that I've studied this program, I've really come to think of it more as a subsidy program. And I'm going to borrow from one of our policymakers here in the state of Minnesota who has called 340B a hidden subsidy for providers. So the program allows certain providers, which many of them are hospitals, to profit from the spread between what insurers reimburse and the discounted prices that they're guaranteed through the 340B program. And there's really no restrictions on how you use those dollars, and there's no oversight. So as you might expect, the program has become pretty popular because it's a great way to bring a facility from red to black, so to speak. The controversy here comes in because not all of these hospitals that are getting this hidden subsidy are actually doing that much safety net care. And so if we're giving a big subsidy to a bunch of hospitals and some of them are using it to aid safety net reliant patients and some of them aren't, you know, you got to ask, what is all that subsidy going to in the other group of hospitals?
So that question is a great transition back to you, Kelsey. In terms of what research questions did you and your co-authors seek to address, and what data and outcomes did you assess in your study?
Yeah, so as Dr. Nick-Pay mentioned, several past studies, including work by Dr. Nick-Pay, have evaluated 340B and safety net services and engagement among hospitals, and have generally found that hospitals are not really changing their safety net engagement or service provisions in response to 340B participation for hospitals on average. And so we were really interested in identifying if there are some hospitals that behave in a way that is concordant with the original intention of the program to allow providers to continue to provide or sustain comprehensive patient services. And understanding whether that impact varied by specific hospital characteristics like hospital ownership. So to assess that question, we used data from the American Hospital Association survey and examined the availability of hospital services as our primary outcome. And we assessed services that are thought to be relatively unprofitable and vulnerable to closure, such as psychiatric, substance use, and obstetric services. And we also examined more profitable services like orthopedic and oncology services.
And with that as introduction, what were the main findings of your study? And did any of your findings surprise you?
Yes. Yeah, so we found that public hospitals that were newly participating in 340B during our study period did increase their total number of unprofitable services by around 11% relative to baseline. And that is compared to public hospitals that never participated in the 340B program during our study period. But for nonprofit hospitals, we found no change in service provisions except for an increase in oncology services. And so as to whether these findings are surprising, for nonprofit hospital, these findings are very consistent to prior studies that find limited changes in service provision or safety net engagement following 340B participation. But for public hospitals, we knew from prior work that public hospitals are generally more mission-oriented relative to nonprofit hospitals and are more likely to offer unprofitable service lines in general compared to other hospital types. And we also know that public hospitals have historically been in tenuous financial positions. So I do think the fact that our findings show that public hospitals use 340B savings to sustain unprofitable services really shouldn't be all that surprising.
Thanks. And with that as the main finding, what are the implications in your view for policymakers based on your study?
Again, these findings show that I think some, you know, public hospitals really are probably reliant on 340B savings to continue to provide essential service lines. And so I hope this study will inform policymakers and regulators on the need to consider the heterogeneity and how program savings are used, especially when considering changes to the program, like changes in program eligibility. And really be able to support those hospitals that are able to expand access to essential services like public hospitals.
Thanks. Saya, you've published a number of studies about the 340B program, including your commentary about Kelsey's study in JAMA Health Forum. How do you see the findings of this new study adding to our understanding of the program relative to the work that's been done previously?
Yeah, I think that this paper is really valuable because it's helping us differentiate between hospitals that participate in this program in terms of their ownership, and what that tracks to is potentially their safety net engagement. So the work that I've been a part of, some of it which now is getting quite old, was really about answering this fundamental question. Are hospitals that are participating in this program using their 340B dollars to benefit patients, looking broadly across hospitals? And you have to understand that at this point in time, really all we knew about 340B hospital safety net engagement came from anecdotal surveys of individual hospitals or groups of hospitals and what they were doing. And so we were really trying to push the field by looking across all hospitals. And it's good because it's systematic, but it's bad because it's an average across all hospitals. What Dr. Owsley's study is doing is really thinking about what's a reasonable way to look within that broad category of hospitals. And I think what they find is very convincing evidence that public hospitals are using this program differently. They're offering these high community value but less profitable services. And I think it seems very likely that if those services are offered, patients are going to use them because public hospitals may be less likely to turn patients away because they don't have the right type of insurance or they're uninsured altogether.
Thanks. And Sai, what are some of the changes to the 340B program that Congress may be considering? And how might those changes affect some of the major stakeholders, such as pharmaceutical manufacturers or the participating healthcare systems?
Yeah, so there is a very, very active playing field right now in Congress, in the courts around 340B. So in terms of what Congress is thinking about, the biggest policy that is of interest right now is the SUSTAIN Act. And the SUSTAIN Act, from my view, seems that it has the goal of clarifying some of the murkier areas of the 340B program. So it's trying to get lawmakers to weigh in on these important questions that affect the size of the program and who participates. Things like, what sites can discounted drugs be dispersed through? Are they pharmacies that are very far away or pharmacies that are within 40 miles, for example? Another big question that they want to weigh in on is, who counts as an eligible patient? Right now, the statute is not specific enough to keep the program at the size that I believe Congress intended it to be. So that's what's happening in Congress. But I will also say that there are some very interesting things right now that are happening at the state level. This past legislative session, I believe 4 states attempted to do some form of 340B transparency. 2 were unsuccessful, but 2 ended up actually passing something. And those 2 states are Minnesota, where I live, and Maine. I know a little bit more about Minnesota because I live here. What Minnesota's policy has done is it is providing the first look, which should be available later this year, into how big are the 340B profits for hospitals and also other types of providers that are participating in the program. And those data will be incredibly valuable when they come out because they will provide for the first time ever across all the participants in one state, a look at who's benefiting and who is not.
That's fascinating. It sounds like our listeners have a lot to watch for on both the federal and state levels for changes to come and new information about the 340B program. So, Kelsey and Sai, at the end of our podcast interviews, we like to ask a couple questions of our guest authors. And I'll pose the first one to you, Kelsey, and then Sai. What's the best advice you've been given about your career, particularly for developing policy-relevant work, such as your article in JAMA Health Forum?
One of the best pieces of advice I received while doing my doctoral training was just to really stay up to date on current issues in the field by reading daily news briefs or listening to podcasts. I think it's really important to make sure our research that we conduct is relevant and actionable. And I think it has really helped me to identify new research questions that could be explored. So I think just being aware of what is happening in health policy has actually made me a much better researcher.
Thanks. Sai, what would you have to add?
So this sounds a little silly, but I actually really think that a good piece of advice is to follow your passions. I can't tell you how many times working on this program that people told me that I shouldn't be working on it, either because it didn't have a clear implication for economic theory, or it didn't have a nice statistical application to study, or a statistical method that worked very nicely to demonstrate the causal effects of the program. I just became so interested in this program and so amazed at the unknowns. And I think that if you find something that you are really passionate about, where you really can create new facts that are relevant for policymaking, you should do it. This work has been by far the most rewarding of my career to date.
Saya, we also like to ask our guest authors, what's the biggest change you expect over the next 5 years related to health policy in general or the 340B program specifically?
With respect to the 340B program, I am thinking about two things over the next 5 years. The first is that I believe that transparency, thanks to the work that states have been doing, is going to become an inevitability, whether it rolls out across states over time or whether it's something that is introduced federally. I believe that that will be something that we have in the next 5 years. The second issue is that we are going to see a lot more fighting about 340B in the courts. And that's because there's so many unanswered questions that if we don't get that clarity from the SUSTAIN Act, they will continue to multiply upon themselves. And we will get more hospitals fighting with each other over discounts or fighting with pharmaceutical manufacturer over where they get a discount. So I really think that over the next 5 years, we will see a lot more happening through the courts.
And Kelsey, what do you see as some of the biggest changes on the horizon in health policy or the 340B program?
I mean, I definitely agree with everything Dr. Nick Pei said related to the 340B program. For hospitals as a whole, especially nonprofit hospitals, I do expect there to be more conversations surrounding what we actually expect from hospitals in terms of safety net engagement and community benefit spending, especially as it relates to their nonprofit tax exemption. And so I think there's definitely going to be a lot more conversation surrounding whether we should have clear guidelines and requirements on how hospitals are expected to serve their communities.
Well, on that note, I want to thank our guest authors, Dr. Kelsey Ousley from the University of Arkansas for Medical Sciences, and Dr. Saya Nikpe from the University of Minnesota School of Public Health. This episode was produced by Shelley Steffens at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com. Thanks for listening.